This is Game Nights, episode number 49, recorded March 26th, 2017, The Legend of Shaker Heights, Chapter 6. Hello, everybody. Welcome to this episode of Game Nights, the show that takes Dungeons & Dragons to the same level as everyone else plays it at. I'm Shaun Jennings, joined, as always, by three heroes who we'll see if they end up being heroes by the end of the hour. It is Matt, Colby, and Dan. And they are here to continue our exciting quest, The Legend of Shaker Heights, Chapter 6. Gentlemen, welcome back.
Thank you.
Welcome.
This is very exciting. I've got my note cards here filled with all the action for the next hour. Why don't we catch the folks at home up, and probably you guys up too. It's been what, 3 weeks or
been
so since we've played. So.
Been a hot minute.
At least we didn't take any hostages last episode.
No.
Or trick anybody into joining us on a long quest and then getting killed.
We just had to fight like a dozen tiny, tiny goblin things.
You did. And you succeeded and you left their bodies in piles all over the place. No, what happened last time around was that you folks encountered the leader of the Order of the Cleanse. His name, Carol Wickersham. You very quickly dispatched with his goblins and he cowered in fear and begged for mercy. And you gave it to him, surprisingly. Although Matt tried desperately to light him on fire, among other things. So you took his robes, tied him up, and in your quest to explore more of the area where you're imprisoned, you went into the quarters and as Colby mentioned, you, encountered a dozen, kobold, lizard guys who it took a while and it wasn't fun, but you dispatched with them. Congratulations. Very good. The three of you, along with your new centaur friend, Vankar, proceeded, towards the sound of rushing water. At that point you decided to split up into two groups of two. Colby and Dan backtracked towards the Great Hall, towards, the altar, which, Carol told you about. Meanwhile, Matt and Vankar continued the way you had been going, and we ended the show where they had a choice whether they went through the unmarked door or went to the hallway on the left towards the sound of water. Of course, on the right was the pit filled of goblins that Dan made walk to their own deaths. Matt made them walk towards their own deaths. Is that a good recap, guys?
Yeah, that was so good.
Feeling back in it? All right. So, you've already split up. Colby and Dan backtracked through the door towards the Great Hall, where Carol is still tied, basically semi-nude to nude, to the dining table there. You left him.
It's very graphic.
Well, it's you know, you guys really embarrassed him. It wasn't nice. I mean, I know he was going to sacrifice you to the demigod of watery death, but, you know, you didn't have to embarrass him. And meanwhile, Matt and Vankar had a decision. Akmenos and Vankar had a choice to make. And we're going to continue the action with Vankar and Akmenos. Gentlemen, you were standing there looking at either the unmarked door or a hallway, the end of which was not clear, towards the sound of water.
Okay. Before we start, I turn to Vankar and I say, Vankar, I want you to know something about me. It's very important. From now on, I want you specifically to start calling me Johnny. That's my nickname, Johnny. My last name is Quest, so my name is Johnny Quest. But I only want you to call me that.
Are you related to
that? We can proceed with the adventure.
Yo, I don't know anything about what you're talking about. Johnny Quest? I don't know anything about this Johnny Quest fellow. Come on. What are you talking about? Get out of town.
So do you just keep your accent suppressed when you're around the other guys and you just feel comfortable like bringing it out here? Cause
I'm real sensitive about it. You seem like a cool dude. So, you know, I'll talk to you my accent.
Forget about
it. Or I forget about it sometimes. Either way, don't worry about it. Hey, look, you want to be Johnny Quest, you can be whoever you want to be. You know, that's fine, Johnny. Whatever floats your boat.
Thanks. I knew you'd understand, Vankar. That being said, I think we should go through this door that is unmarked. I don't even want to bother with a perception check. I just want to do it.
I'm just looking for a way out, man. So, you know, whatever gets us out of this hellhole, man. I'm ready to get out of here.
Feeling real confident about that. I go to try to open the door.
And the door is locked.
Damn it. Of course.
Now, which of you three had the keys?
I think Dan did. Definitely wasn't.
It could be. I didn't write down that I have any keys. But if you say I have them, I reach in my pocket. I check if I have keys.
I don't know. Hang on. Let me get my keys. We'll find out if you have keys. You do not have the keys.
All right.
Also, aren't you guys in a different part of the?
Yeah, so they're not near you. I'm just trying. I'm just trying to see.
Do I have the keys?
I don't know. No, you do not have the keys.
Oh.
Nobody
does Matt have the keys.
I don't know. Would you like to know? Let's find out. Does Matt have the? Matt has the keys.
Cool. So let's open them up with the keys then.
All right. So Matt tries the key to the door. He hears a click, and you just open the door.
Yep.
He opens the door. The room is dark inside. You can't really see much. They're clearly, I mean, you haven't seen any windows since you've been here, so it's clear that, no light means pretty dark.
Do I know a magic spell that can illuminate this room?
I don't know. Do you?
I don't think I do. I know some mild spells, but I think they're all like healing spells. No, I don't know anything that can light a room.
Explorer's pack?
I do not. I have a diplomat's pack with the lamp in it. There's a lamp. Hey. Okay. All right. I take the lamp out of the diplomat's pack, and I illuminate the room.
All right. It illuminates a circle around you guys with a certain dimension, and within that you can't really – you don't see the other walls of the room. You just kind of see the floor into the room a little bit.
Okay. I walk through the room. Oh, Vankar, how about you go in front of me, buddy?
Hey, you're the one with the lantern, pal. Get out of here. What are you doing?
Well, I mean, it's just that you have half the body of a horse, so I'm assuming if anybody sees you, they'll be really freaked out and run away.
I'm just a giant, scary demon.
Well, you know what? I look pretty intimidating.
First of all, I take offense to that. That's not a very nice thing to say. I'm very sensitive about my horse half. Don't do that. That's not nice.
You should be who you are, Vankar.
I'm trying, man. I'm trying. And you know, you point these things out. I'm real sensitive about it. You know what? You fool. And no, you have the lantern. Go through the fucking door.
I thought I already went through the door.
Well, go into the room. Okay. Jesus Christ! Well, this guy, Johnny, come on.
I look pretty spooky anyway, so I'm gonna walk through the door first. I walk a little bit more into the room.
And Vankar follows.
Now I want to do a perception check.
Okay.
I rolled a 9.
Oh, that's not very good. You
wait. With my little, it's actually a 12 with my buffer. It's been a long time since we've done this.
Yeah, that's fine. You notice two things. One, the door has closed behind you. And two, you notice 6 pairs of glowing eyes on the other side of the room.
Oh. Vankar, get us out of here.
why are you looking at me, man?
Because you could probably kick through that door with your horse feet. Come on, kick it. Give it
horse
a kick.
Horse feet, they're called hooves. Horse feet. Get out of town.
You know what? I guess I'm just going to see who these six eyes belong to. I shine the light in the direction of these eyes.
There you see 3 hyenas.
What? Hyenas?
Standing there staring at you. Hyenas? Look it up. They're common to this area. I didn't just pick them randomly. They're in D&D. I did not make this up.
They're just in this room? It's just the hyena room?
Absolutely.
I
don't know why that sounds unusual.
All right. Well,
you have a hyena room?
Yeah.
I take out my weapon, which is a sickle. No, I think I better use my rapier for this. I take out my rapier.
Okay. Vankar doesn't have any weapons. He just has his horse body, as Matt would say, inappropriately.
So give it a kick.
Do you wish to do battle, Matt?
No. I'm going to find out what the hyenas want first.
Okay, go ahead.
Hyenas, I come in peace. I might have some food here to offer you. Do I have any food with me, Shaun?
I don't have your sheet in front of me, do you?
I don't think I have any food.
Okay.
Okay. I think I'm just gonna fight them then.
Are you do you wanna hear their response?
Yeah. I really do.
All right. One of them lunges at you and tries to bite you. Quick.
Okay.
Roll.
Oh shit.
Saving throw.
14.
We'll say it's good enough. But what happens is that you, as you swing to kind of, not like I did my microphone, you swing to knock him away, but you swing with your hand that contains the lantern, at which point you throw the lantern on the other side of the room, it smashes into a million pieces, and now you're in pitch black darkness.
Well, here we go.
No, isn't the room going to catch fire? Because there's fire in the lamp.
It's made of sand. It's not going to catch on fire.
It's going to turn into glass.
I'll give you... another weapon. No, I'll give you one turn where the slowly dissipating burning embers provide enough light for you to see something where you're not disadvantaged. After that, you will be disadvantaged.
Crap. Okay, battle time.
Shouldn't have tried to talk to him, Matt.
That'll teach you.
I rolled a 12 for initiative.
Okay, let's see. Matt rolled a 12. Vankar.
Should I roll for Vankar?
No, I did 16. Hyena 1 rolled a 6. Hyena 2 rolled another 6. And Hyena 3 rolled a 2, which makes our order Vankar, Matt, Hyena 1, Hyena 2, Hyena 3. Pretty simple, right? All right. Vankar. Vankar uses a hooves attack. Let's see how he does. He rolls a 3. It is unsuccessful. Even in the low light, he can't see too well. All right, Matt, go ahead. It's your turn.
11.
11, that does not hit. That is a miss, which makes it Hyena 1's turn. Let's see here how we do. Attacking Matt rolls a 6.
Doesn't do it.
Okay. Hyena 2 rolls a 12 against Matt.
Also ineffective.
And Hyena 3 rolls a 9 against Matt.
Ineffective.
Okay, Vankar's turn. This is going to end up being like every fight we ever do. Taking forever. Let's see, Vankar rolls a 12. It is ineffective. Matt, it's your turn.
Matt rolled a 2.
That is ineffective. And we're all at disadvantage at this point, by the way, I should know. Which makes it Hyena 1's turn. Hyena 1 rolls an 8 against Matt.
Nope.
Oh, my God. Hyena 2 rolls a 10 against Matt. Hyena 3 rolls a 2 against Matt. Nope. Vankar. Oh, my God. Vankar rolls a 5. Does not hit. Matt, go ahead.
Oh, 18.
Hey, well, but what about your disadvantage?
So that means I have to roll again?
Yeah.
8.
Okay, that is a miss. Matt, you're welcome to try something creative at this point. This seems like a good opportunity for you to...
So you said this whole room is made out of sand, right?
Basically, what little you saw of it.
All right. So I pick up a handful of sand. I throw it up in the air. And trying to get some of it in the hyena's eyes.
All right, go ahead. Roll your dice. Without no disadvantage, because it's really just luck at this point.
Okay, so should I roll a d20?
Yeah.
Okay, I got a 9.
Yeah, it doesn't work. It doesn't work. Turns out you can't do that. Don't you have aren't you a demon? Don't you have fire breath or something?
No, that's racist. And I get shit for saying you have half a horse body.
You're the worst demon I've ever met. You suck at being a demon.
I just look like a demon.
Vankar is great at being half a horse. Let's see. Hyena 1 rolls a 13 against, we'll say, Vankar. And it is a hit. against Venkar. Let's see how he did. That is a 1d6. And that would be a 2. 2 damage to Venkar. Oh, Lord. Let's see. Hyena 2 rolls a 4. Hyena 3 rolls a 2. It is Vankar's turn. Vankar, okay, so when you guys entered the room, Matt was in front, Vankar directly behind him, which means Vankar's horse ass is basically back against the door.
Yeah.
So he's going to take his rear hooves, and he's going to try and kick the door
horse
down.
Legs.
Sounds good.
I'm sorry, what?
Horse legs.
Horse legs. Yes, we're very scientific here. The technical term, horse legs. And he rolls a 1. He tries to kick it, and it does not work. Matt, it's your turn.
Okay. I do a combat roll to get on the other side of the hyenas.
Okay.
like a cool like roll, like sure. Something you would see in an action movie. Do I have to do a dexterity check?
Sure.
Okay. Oh, nice. I got a 23 on that.
Wow.
So this is a really cool action roll.
Matt goes to do a spin, rolls over, and rolls on top of one of the hyenas.
Nice.
And does 3 damage.
Oh, I damaged him. All right, cool. So now I'm on the other side of the hyenas.
And we'll say that's hyena 1.
And I guess that's my turn.
It is, and it's hyena 1's turn, and he's very irritated that you you rolled on top of him, and he rolled a 2 against you.
Okay.
Hyena 2 rolled a 16 against you, Matt.
Oh, that hurts.
Yeah, you bet your ass it does. And that's 5 damage.
Okay.
Hyena 3 rolls an 8. Which does not hit. It is Vankar's turn. Vankar is again going to try and kick the door down. And he rolls a 12. He kicks the door. It's halfway broken, but not completely broken. Hyena 1's turn. Rolled a 12. That is not a hit. Hyena 2... rolled an 8, not a hit. Everyone's fumbling in the dark. All right, let's see. Hyena 3 rolls a 14 against Vankar, which is a hit, and does 3 damage. As I write that down. It is Vankar's turn. He's going to once again going to try to kick the door down. Where'd my dice go? Oh, there it is. Okay. And he rolls a 15. He kicks the door down.
All right.
Light floods into the room, illuminating enough so that you can see the two of you standing there and a couple of hyenas that are pointing in all different directions because they didn't know where they were looking. but now they clearly see the two of you.
Yes. So the disadvantage is gone now.
That is correct. Matt, it is your turn.
Okay. I really want to know what's in this room.
Okay.
So now I'm on the other side of the hyenas, so I'm facing the part of the room that was not illuminated previously.
You're facing Vankar in the door.
Okay. I want to turn around and face the other way.
Okay.
Look at the other side of the room.
Yep.
And I want to do a perception check.
Sure.
Shit. 7.
Okay, you don't see too much. Directly in front of your feet are some metal shackles. You infer that's probably where the hyenas were chained up at one point. But that's really all you see.
Okay. It's my turn.
And it was. In the middle of battle, Matt looks around the room. I'm not going to judge you, but you know, that's you have to live with that decision.
These are no match for me.
For all Johnny. Right. Let's see here. Hyena 1's going to attack Matt and rolls a 15.
I think that's a tie.
Okay. So we'll say that's a miss. Hyena 2 is going to attack Matt, rolls a 2. Hyena 3 is going to attack Matt and rolls a 4. Venkar has decided he's had enough and leaves the room.
What?
He backs through the door and you lose sight of him.
Treason.
He's done. He's had enough. These hyenas suck. All three hyenas turn their attention to Matt. Matt, it's your turn.
All right, so I'm still facing the other way. I really want to know what's in this room.
Three hyenas between you and the door.
One more perception check.
All right.
One more perception check. 7.
You see exactly.
Add the modifier. Wait. I keep forgetting to add the modifier. It's actually a 10.
You see exactly what you saw last time.
Okay.
You're going to have to do better. All right. Is at this point, we're going to take a timeout on that story. Matt has three hyenas between him and the door, and Vankar's nowhere to be found. Meanwhile, Colby and Dan have left. They walk down the hallway towards the Great Hall. We'll assume you make it to the Great Hall. There you see Carol Wickersham still tied to the table, mostly nude, a lot of dead kobolds all over the floor. Where do you proceed?
Wait, why was he nude again?
Because Matt took his robes. Partly to humiliate him, partly to see if he could confuse stupid goblins into thinking he was more important than he was.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Okay, that's cool.
Are you saying that Matt's not important?
I'm saying with those robes, he's very important.
The robes are... Right.
So we're going for the door that we think to have the treasure at the end of it.
Okay, yeah. Towards the altar?
Yeah, right, the altar.
Sure. As you guys walk around with Carol, hey guys, you're back! Oh, this is great, thanks! I'm so glad you're here!
Shut up, Carol!
Okay. Whatever you say, guys.
Alright, to the door.
Alright, you go to the door.
Should we try and perceive or something?
I'll try to perceive the other... I'll check the other side of the door for safety, but the door is still closed.
Yes.
And I'll check the door itself.
Yes.
All right. Oh, it's been so long, I forgot what my modifiers are. 12.
You put your ear against the door. You don't really hear anything on the other side. It sounds like a door would sound like.
Right.
You reach and try for the handle. It's unlocked.
All right. I open the door.
Okay. You open the door. You look down the door and you see a hallway. That just seems like a regular boring hallway. Goes down, turns right.
Well, we go down.
Okay.
And turn right.
All right. You go down. You turn right. And another very short hallway that opens up into this big cavernous space. And I would like you to roll a perception check to see exactly what you see in that big cavernous space.
Should we both do that?
Sure, why don't you both do it? And we'll...
I got...
19.
8.
All right. Fair enough. So that averages out to what? Roughly 14?
Oh, whoa. That's not
up.
How it works.
No, it's totally how it works. So you guys roll 14. That's fine. So you look in and you see what is very clearly some sort of altar. There's a giant sculpture of a Poseidon-esque looking, for our normal people here, so you have something to compare it to, a Poseidon-esque sculpture of some sort of water creature. It's tall. It's got to be 30 feet high. It's big. It's tall. It's a big statue. He's clutching a trident, big dark eyes, looks really quite menacing. And surrounding him are flames behind him.
Flames. Like real flames?
Like real
fucking...
ass
flames?
What, yeah,
not like sculpture flames?
No,
like actual
no, like
fire.
Actual fire.
Okay.
Creating, it's in like a half circle, right? So you can kind of see with this, and then behind him to backlight. Very dramatic.
Mm.
And directly in front of the statue, you see a column. And there's something on top of the column, but you didn't roll enough points to get a good look at it yet. But that sort of... And then there's fire around that column.
Gotcha.
Fully around it?
fully around right? the pillar, yes. So, here, let me see if I can draw you.
I bet this thing's going to come to life.
Oh, God.
Either that or there's like a dragon on the column or something.
So what you've got is kind of, if you can see that, that's the little rectangle there is the statue. And you've got this long half circle of flames very dramatically. And right in front of it,
you know what?
You see the little column with flames around it as well.
We're going to have to Indiana Jones this shit. You got a bag of sand?
Well, the column's surrounded by flames, isn't it? So we got to deal with that.
We can get past that. We can get past that.
I'm excited to see what happens. This is in the corner of this large room, and it's quite menacing in its size and scope. That's basically what you see.
Is it? And there's nothing else in the room?
That's what you see.
Okay. So, yes.
So there is. Well, I guess we should take a closer look at this. See if we can figure out what's on top of the pillar thing.
Hmm. If only Dawkins was here.
Indeed. I guess hawks probably don't like caves that much.
No.
Bit of a ceiling height issue.
Right. Is the pillar really tall?
It's probably, I don't know, 5 feet. You know, it's, you can, if you had to reach for what was on top of it, you could.
Okay. Like I could or Dan could?
No, Dan could. You, no, oh, okay. You, of course you couldn't.
But I could throw Colby. I could chuck him like a shot put.
I can also use
Mage him over the top of the pillar. He grabs a thing on top and then skids.
Seriously, I would really love for you to do that. Like I'm not even kidding. That would be kind of amazing.
Well, grab him by the collar. Whip him around that way.
Yep. Yep. I would.
I'm up for it if you are.
Let's try, we gotta
angle it so I don't go like flying into the flames behind the.
It would have to be extremely precise. I would have to roll a 20, really, because any too high you miss the thing, you go into the flames. Too low, you crash into the pillar.
I'd give you a bit of flexibility on that, but not much. You'd have a very plus or minus 2 maybe on that 20.
I think one thing we could do is like stand if we initiate the throw from between the background flames in the pillar and the statue, then at least we avoid, like, I can't get thrown into the background flames.
That's a good idea.
So there's still the pillar
flames. Background flames.
Right. No.
Let's try to see what is on top, though, because if it's something that'll kill you,
it's you just don't, a you don't sword. Like... okay.
Now you could stand on my shoulders if that would help you get a better look.
That's true.
I think then at that point you would be above, you would be over 5 feet. Actually, that's probably the thing to do.
Yeah.
How's your acrobatics looking?
My acrobatics is pretty robust, I think.
Okay, good. All right, I think that's it.
As in, it's plus 6, so.
Oh, fuck yeah. Get on my shoulders, and let's see what that thing looks like, and then we can make a decision.
All right, I'm going to roll an acrobat. Oh, God. I got a 9. That's with my plus.
Wow. So Colby tries to get on top of Dan's shoulders. They wobble around and kind of stumble around, and then they both fall over. Nobody's hurt, but they're kind
should
of embarrassed.
Should we try that again?
Yeah.
That's what it's rusty. I'm just a little rusty. 15 this time.
Colby once again tries to get on Dan's back. He gets up there. They wobble around, stumble a little bit, eventually regain their balance. And Colby is up on Dan's shoulders. However, Dan is struggling under the weight a little bit, so whatever they need to look at, they should do it sooner rather than later.
All right, should we like chicken walk over to the
No, we're right in front of it. We were standing right in front of it. Yeah.
Should I perceive then? Do I need to percept?
Yeah. Let's see what that thing is.
God, I got a 2. Can I percept again?
You can percept again, but this is it.
Okay. 10.
Before you fall off of Dan's shoulders for a second time, you get a quick glance at what's on top of that pillar. It looks sort of like a glass bottle, and there's something inside of it. The bottle is corked, and there's some sort of object inside, but you didn't get a great look at what it was. You fall over.
All right.
Well, so...
When you were on top of my shoulders, how far were you from the bottle?
Probably...
how far from the edge of the flames to the bottle as a bird flies?
So it would go... You guys to the edge of the flames is probably 5 to 7 feet. The flames to the bottle would probably be just another foot or two.
Wait. There's 5 to 7 feet of flames between us and this pillar?
No, between you and where the flames start. But we're 7 feet away.
We're standing at the flames now so that we could get as good a look at the...
Did I hear you say you approached the flames? I heard Colby get up on your shoulders.
All right. Well, fine then. I guess we didn't. Okay. So it's the flame. The difference between the edge of the flames and the pillar is 1 to 2 feet.
Basically, yeah.
Could you jump over the flames, and is there ground between the flames and the pillar?
There is that little foot space that it is it's not, the whole thing isn't fire. However, the fire is up about 3 to 4 feet, so you know it certainly wouldn't be easy to get over.
So, here's what I'm thinking. As much fun as it would be to try and acrobatics our way to the top of this pillar, I have the mage hand spell, so I think I can just pick up the thing.
Good idea.
Yeah.
I'm down.
Yeah. And then it says, I can retrieve an item from an open container. So, and I can move it up to 30 feet. So it should be good. So unless the dungeon master objects.
No, I don't. As far as I can tell, I don't object.
Okay, I'm gonna conjure my mage hand, snatch the bottle.
Suddenly, as you're conjuring the mage hand, you hear a voice. This voice doesn't seem to come from any one direction, but rather all directions. And the voice says, "Halt!"
But okay.
It says what?
Halt.
Talk?
It said halt.
Halt. Oh.
I shouldn't try and be dramatic with the voice acting. Yeah. Halt.
It's German. A German voice.
Yes, exactly.
Who's that?
Are you asking me or are you asking the voice?
Well, I'm asking the voice. Sorry. Mal says, who's that?
Halt.
Who's there?
It says halt again. Halt.
I already halted. I'm not moving.
Leave this place.
No.
I said, leave this place.
I don't think so.
Leave now, and your life will be spared.
I don't know. What do you think we should do, Dan? Should we just leave?
No. Here's what I'm thinking. I'm thinking this thing has a map to that place that we want to go to.
The other half of the map that we have, perhaps.
Right. Perhaps. Mm-hmm. Right. So, it doesn't seem like it's very interested in talking.
That's true.
Right? So I don't think there's any negotiation to be done here.
This could be a Wizard of Oz situation where we need to find the guy behind the curtain.
The voice starts talking again. I know you're thinking about doing something. Should you try, the protector will stop you. Leave now with your lives.
I'm going to do a perception check to see if I can tell where this voice is coming from.
Good call.
Natural 20.
Whoa!
Wow!
You're just so unfair. It's unbelievable. It's very upsetting. The voice is coming from inside your head. You're not hearing it. You're thinking it.
All right.
Interesting. It's getting crowded in here with the quill and the
all these voices. Get out of
here. Yeah. I say take it anyways. I mean, it's clearly very important. Yeah. It's got to be why we're here.
All right, all right. So I'm as quickly as I can, I'm gonna summon the mage hand, snatch the bottle, and like put it in my rucksack or
rucksack.
All right, the mage hand works. He conjures it. He goes, grabs the bottle, pulls it towards him, and it's in Colby's hand. Suddenly, the ground beneath you starts to shake. And the dust on the ground around you starts to shake. Uh-oh. But the dust starts to move towards itself, creating in two piles directly in front of you between you and the altar. And the dust starts to rise and form into shapes. The shape...
It's a sandcastle.
...of two mummies.
Oh, no!
Cut to... Matt and Vanguard.
Mummies are D&D canon?
You don't believe me. There you go. They absolutely are.
That is the creepiest picture of a mummy I've ever seen.
Oh, they're absolutely terrifying. By the way, we've encountered mummies. We encountered mummies on the last quest, if you remember. You'll remember a particular attack of theirs in a minute. But before we get to that, we have to return to Matt, who is currently confronted by three hyenas, left alone. Vankar has abandoned him. In a room that is now mostly lit. Matt can see it contains nothing but three hyenas in the shackles where they're normally kept, in the hyena storage room. And he's still under attack. Matt will give you the opportunity to take an action before the hyenas all attack you.
I'll take an action here. You see, if there's one thing about hyenas that I've learned over the years, it's that they can't resist the power of music.
I was hoping you'd do this. Yes. Okay.
So with that, which actually that's something that Akmenos just says out loud to the hyenas and to no one in particular, except for the audience at home. And he takes out his bard's mandolin and he starts singing a song about hyenas. And it goes a little something like this. Hyena, hyena, hyena. And he just keeps saying that over and over again. And as he sings, he starts to turn into a hyena tamer.
Could you describe what that looks like to the folks at home?
It's like... kind of like one of those people at the zoo that wear like those khaki shirts
with the four pockets.
Yeah, with the all the pockets. Yes, and like a safari hat. Okay, and he's singing this song about the hyenas, and I'm not sure what to do to see if the hyenas are affected by this song or not. I guess I roll something.
No, I don't think you have to. Only because you You've already
because you actually sang the song.
Yeah, and you have that ability. Yeah. And in this case, you may not know this. Hyenas are actually quite vocal animals. Actually, that is one of their sort of skills and focuses. So, you were in luck, Matt, because they first of all, time out. I don't know why you wouldn't change into Carol Wickersham or someone they recognize instead of someone who looks. But okay, that's you did it. They don't really care that you look like a hyena tamer because they've never seen one before, but they do like your song a lot, and they seem to go from being quite angry to quite mild, and they don't seem to be in attack mode, so they're no longer attacking you. I would not go so far as to say they trust you, but they're certainly not interested in attacking you.
So maybe riding one of them out of here would not be the best idea.
You can try. I encourage you, in fact, to try. But that's your decision to make. What I can tell you is they seem to have... They're all staring at you, but they seem to have relaxed.
I think I'm good here. I'm going to try to slip away, at least onto the other side of them, unnoticed. But I'm still playing the mandolin as I'm moving, and I'm still facing towards them, so they can still hear my music.
I would like you to roll a dexterity check, if you wouldn't mind, and we'll see if you can do it without tripping over your own 2 feet.
Okay, I got a 13.
Okay, while playing, can you sing the song again?
Hyena, hyena, hyena.
Matt edges his way around the hyenas towards the door, and they stare at him and with their eyes follow him as he walks around the room, and he walks out, and they seem to let him leave.
Okay, so now I need to find that bastard Vankar who ditched me.
You look around, he is nowhere to be seen.
What? Oh, I should shut the door. All right, I shut the door.
You can't. So Vankar kicked it clean in half.
That's right, he did. Okay. Where did the Vankar go? Okay, you know what? I'm going to proceed on without him.
Okay, well, you can either go back towards the Great Hall or you can head towards the water sound.
I'm going to head towards the water sound.
Okay, you head down the hall. And this also opens up into a large cavernous room. I would like you to roll a perception check.
7.
You look and you see what appears to be this is a large room, it's quite large, and you see over in one corner what appears to be a body of water. It appears to be not the size of a large, an Olympic-sized swimming pool body of water, in the corner, surrounded by rocks. Behind it, you see a waterfall. And standing at the edge of the water is none other than your good friend and mine, Mr. Vankar, who is standing at the edge of the water, looking at it. And that's pretty much all you see in the room.
Okay. Does Vankar see me? Can he see me?
He does not notice that you entered.
Okay. I guess I'm going to walk forward towards the water. And I'm going to stare into the water.
Vankar notices you enter. Hey, Matt, there you are. Where you been, man? Where you at?
So how close to Vankar am I?
Well, he's standing at the edge of the water. If you're also standing at the edge of the water, then I'd say pretty close.
Okay. I say to Vankar, I've been pretty good, man. I missed you back there with those hyenas, man. What was up with that? Where did you go?
Man, that shit was crazy with the hyenas and the, you know, man, that was nuts. I'm glad we could get out of that one. That was a tough jam.
Yeah, I'm glad we could get out of that one too, Vankar.
Check out what I found, all this water.
Yeah, what's up with this water?
This is crazy.
I say, oh, Vankar, do you smell that?
What the rock is cooking? I don't know. What?
No, no. Do you smell that, Vankar? Something in here smells really bad.
I don't smell anything.
I think it might be that water. Vankar, can you lean over and smell that water for me?
Okay. And he bends over, but because he's half a horse, he can really only bend at his waist, which is about the height of a horse's head, so he can't really get very close to the water.
All right, I grab Vankar's head and I shove it in the water. And I hold it down. And I don't let go until he's dead.
I want you. You're going to roll an attack roll on that.
15. Oh. Best attack roll I've rolled all day.
And wouldn't you know it, it hits.
Vankar's dead.
And we're going to have you roll it once to cut his hit points in half, but you got to roll it again successfully to kill him. He's a big dude.
That's true. He's half a horse.
He's half. You really got to kill for two at this point. You've killed the horse half. Now you have to kill the man half.
I just rolled 15.
That is enough to hit as well. You have successfully Vankar. And then he just sort of collapses on top of you. Take all two hit points of damage.
Okay. That's I don't want him to be dead. Him. I just wanted it to injure him severely.
No, you killed him.
Oh, shit. No.
You said you wanted to kill him. You rolled twice.
You wanted to kill him if you didn't want to kill him.
I told you he lost half his hit points after the first roll.
No, I thought the second one made him lose half his hit
points. No, you killed him. He's dead. He's lying on the ground.
Can he be like healing?
You know what? I have a song here. I have a song of healing.
You're going to kill him and then bring him back to life?
Yes. It says cure
really
status
are a devil.
Ailments. Is death a status ailment? Because really, I have two extremes. I have the song of rest, which cures light wounds, and I have the song of healing, which cures status ailments.
Let's say, because I believe, yes, I would believe he would be a status ailment. The problem is,
Matt. Status ailment is like,
unconscious,
poisoned,
or paralyzed.
I burned my hand.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Not
I don't think being dead is a status
ailment. I want to see you try anyway, so go ahead.
All right, I'm playing the song of healing.
And how does that go?
My dear departed friend, Vankar. Oh, Vankar, oh, Vankar. I'm sorry that I drowned you.
I thought that was going to be to the tune of Oh, Christmas Tree for a second there.
Oh, Vankar, oh, Vankar. Please come back home soon.
Vankar is surrounded by an ethereal light as Madison his song. All of a sudden, he starts spitting up water. What happened? Did I fall in the water? What happened?
You said you saw like a fish in the water and you really wanted to try to grab it with your mouth. And then I bet you like $20 that you couldn't do it. So you tried to do it anyway. I knew it was a bad idea, Vankar, but listen, sometimes you just can't be like talked out of things, so
that sounds like something I would do. Thank you for being a good friend, Johnny.
You got it, Vankar, buddy.
can you help me up?
Sure. You got it.
All right.
I help him up.
You're both standing there at the edge of the water. Vankar is a little wobbly because he was dead. and now he's not dead anymore. Thanks, Matt. What do you do now?
Okay. So Vankar, how deep do you think this water goes?
Oh man, I got apparently deep enough for me to drown in. I don't know. I mean, it's got to be somewhat deep. I don't know. I didn't get a good look at it.
There must be some kind of way to determine how deep this water is.
You know what? Why don't I roll a perception check?
Okay, you roll
accent,
that.
His accent is just so horrific. hang on, I gotta pull a sheet here. Perception check is, I'm so rusty. That's wisdom? What is that?
I think it's wisdom.
I don't even know. He rolls a 15. He looks and he sees that the water, you know, we can only see out so far, but it seems to be somewhat shallow. I mean, this isn't, for its size, it doesn't seem to contain a lot of water. He looks at the waterfall, and notices there's something up with that waterfall. That he can't get a great look at. He's still a little dizzy from being dead and all.
So does the waterfall take water out of the pool or put water into the pool?
Do you know how waterfalls work, Matt? it is not a reverse waterfall. It's the same.
All right, it's putting water into the pool. Then there's got to be some kind of drainage system so that the pool doesn't flood. which means if there's a drainage system, there's got to be like a secret pipe or like tunnel that we can get into. And it probably has treasures in it. Okay. This is an enigma. All right, let's investigate around the waterfall first.
Okay.
So we walk over to the base of the waterfall. Is there anywhere to stand on dry land like while we're looking at this, or do we have to be in the water?
Sure. So you walk around the edge of the lake, and there's let's see if I can draw you another diagram here, another one of my fantastic diagrams that are not to scale. I'm working on it here. All right. So there is your there you go. Look at that. Isn't that something? Can you see that okay there? And yeah. So what you're looking at is that is the rocky outcropping where you tried to drown your new horse friend. And that's the water. And there you see that the dark.
That's
the waterfall right there.
Okay.
And then the rocks on the outside, this is the wall. So the waterfall's coming out of the wall. And there's an edge along which you could walk towards the waterfall. Do you get what I'm saying? Does that make sense?
Yes. Yep. Okay. So we walk around the outside edge there toward the waterfall.
Yes. As you approach the waterfall, you notice there is something behind it. I won't play coy.
Something behind the waterfall. All right, I want to do a perception check to see what it is. Oh, perfect 20.
Whoa, how often does that happen?
Yes. All right. So that's a natural 20.
It is.
With my modifier, that's a 23.
Yes, it is. So you look at the waterfall and you see behind it there is clearly some sort of opening. As you approach it, you notice it appears to be some sort of man-made tunnel behind the waterfall that apparently they were trying to hide and didn't do a great job. That leads to somewhere. However, you cannot see exactly where it leads to without going into it.
Okay. So, Vankar, last time I led the way, and it could have just been me, but last time I led the way, we got attacked by a bunch of angry hyenas. I think it might be good luck, shall we say, if you led the way this time. What say you to that?
I trust you. I trust you, man. You know, you got my back. You're looking out for me. You're a good friend. You know, we trust one another. If you want me to go first, man, I'm happy to do so. We'll take care of this.
Hey, Vankar, did when I tried to kill you by drowning you in that pool, did it affect your brain in some way? Are you like brain damaged a little bit, buddy?
Hi, I'm Vankar. Nice to meet you.
I guess that about answers my question.
Let's go through the tunnel, shall we? And I guess the two of you, Vankar in the lead, enter into the tunnel and head towards the great unknown. Cut to Colby and Dan standing in front of the altar with two mummies directly in front of them. The voice enters their heads again. Leave the bottle and leave with your lives.
Are there mummies between us and the door?
No, if you really want to try that, you're welcome to. But no, they're between you and the altar.
Okay. Just curious. Are they like advancing on us, or are they
they're
just there?
Just standing there staring at you with no eyes because they're mummies. They're skull holes.
That's creepy.
Colby, what's in the bottle?
Oh, yeah. Can I look at the bottle?
Yeah, you don't even have to roll a perception check. It's in your hand. it's that close. If you can't see it, you need glasses. You look at the bottle. Inside, there is a rolled up piece of paper tied with a piece of twine inside of the bottle.
All right.
It looks old.
So I say to the voice, if we give you the bottle back, will you let us go?
This one thinks he's smart. The bottle and the object inside.
And the object inside. Okay.
That does not belong to you.
Colby, do you... Here, we're quilling right now. That's a new verb I made up. Here's what I propose. You're a man of some ill repute. You know, you've been around on the streets a little bit. I want you to open up this bottle,
take out the paper that's inside and slide in another paper, another rolled up piece of parchment that you have in your pocket.
All right. I'm going to try to use my sleight of hand.
That's the word I'm
looking for.
Skill, yes. That's the business right there.
in which I also have plus six. Whoa! So, let's see.
Meanwhile, I'm distracting. I'm distracting for the magician's tricks.
How are you distracting? I want to hear specifically.
Well, I'm like, what, you know, what's so great about this piece of paper? Because the way I see it, we seem to be the ones in the bargaining position here. You got to make an offer to us.
Stop distracting. Give us the bottle.
Meanwhile, I rolled 22.
I say, all right.
Bottle. So Colby rolls a 22. He reaches into his pocket, pulls out a small piece of paper, attempts to swap it in and out of the bottle. He succeeds, gets it in the bottle, and with the topper on top of it.
All right. I mean,
I take the bottle from Colby, and I put it down on the ground, and I roll it towards the mummies.
You made the right decision.
All right.
All right. Sorry about that.
We'll be on our way, I guess. Yeah. Should we like check out the rest of the room or anything, or should we get out? All right. I guess we can go back and check on that mystery door or something. Yeah. Cool.
All right. As you guys go to leave the room, which one of you is exiting the room first?
What?
Dan's leaving first.
Okay.
Dan's leaving the room first. Dan is out of the room. Colby's about to get out of the room when he hears a voice. Wait a sec.
Oh, no.
Wait a second. I see what you did there. And then the mummy, from a distance, where's my mummy
from
sheet?
A distance,
attempts to hit Colby with a dreadful glare. Remember dreadful glare back when we?
I don't.
Back when we? Oh, this was not fun.
That was one of the deep hits. Yeah,
it was
the deep cuts.
Which it's let's see, because it doesn't have to be. It can be pretty far from you to attack it. Colby, you have to succeed on a wisdom saving throw.
Oh, that is not my my forte. I got a 3.
All right. Well, that means you... Wait, what'd you roll?
3.
Oh, wow. You actually, by rolling that bad, you actually get even more damage. You are... Because if you had just failed... You would have become frightened, which I forget exactly what that entails. I'd have to look that up. But not only are you now frightened, you're also paralyzed.
Oh.
Colby collapses to the ground, half his body inside the door, half his door out. Half his body outside the door. And on that totally fantastic note, we have got to end this episode. I can't think of a more dramatic place. We've got Colby lying paralyzed on the ground. Dan, who knows what Dan's going to do? He's going to leave him there to die? Is he going to come help his friend? We've got Matt and Vankar going through a mysterious tunnel. You all are going to want to have to tune in next time to see where this adventure goes. But we're out of time this time. So our website, gamenights.tv, go there, get every episode. Past, present, and future, follow the whole story there. Of course, follow us on Twitter at gamenightstv. On behalf of Colby, Dan, and Matt, this is Sean, your Dungeon Master, thanking everybody for joining us and hoping we'll see you next time to continue this exciting adventure here on Game Nights.